Okay, so hi, we're back today talking about college with Dana Ponsky, and I'm so excited to have a conversation today regarding what our students who are looking into high schools should be thinking about just in general around the college process. What kinds of questions should they be asking high schools? What things should they be thinking about, especially as they move into this process of looking at high schools, and maybe also what they shouldn't be thinking about right now because they're looking at high schools. But we're going to talk about all of that today. So Dana, if you would just do me the pleasure of introducing yourself and just share a little bit about your history of work, and we'll go from there. I'll start probing you with all of our good questions.
Hi everyone, I'm Dana Ponsky. I'm an independent college counselor. Dana Ponsky Consulting Services. I have been a college counselor for the last 10 years, and prior to that, for about 10 years, I was a university administrator. So I love college and decided that I would either work for them or help people get to them. It's been a great experience that I've been doing, and for the last year and a half or so, I've been really spending a lot of effort working on my business and growing my business. I work with students primarily from 8th to 12th grade. I do work with college students for the transfer process and also to help with graduate school, but most of my time is spent with high schoolers, just helping to navigate the high school experience and help them then prepare for what is needed for the college application process. So I think of those two things as mutually exclusive and then also one in the same, but I think it's because I think it's really important that high schoolers really enjoy all the ups and downs that can come with high school and experience it for what it is, which is a period of growth and development and challenge and support and, you know, all those other fun things that can go with being a teenager. So I try to really encourage enjoying that time, making sure that it's being used to the best abilities, and making sure that it's being used not just for that specific time, but also to help with planning for the future.
That's so wonderful. And it's wonderful that you have that experience of just a holistic approach in terms of helping students with the process as well as sort of the planning for the future, because I know a lot of my high school students or students who are applying for high school, for example, ask me in particular as a high school advisor what different schools will do for them, I guess you could say, right, in terms of helping with or hindering the college process. So when you start, I guess, with a student who is looking at a high school, what are some things that you would consider at that point, or just sort of the entry point of looking at high schools? What should students be looking at in general? And we'll start there. Yeah.
So one thing to mention, if you're in the New York City system, so to speak, it is a very unique experience to look for a high school in New York. So for those who are not in the New York City region, just to understand, in New York City and in the outer boroughs, you apply to high school. It's not just you're zoned for a specific high school. There are very few students zoned for a specific high school. So with that being said, if you're in the New York City region, what happens is that you have to go ahead and either choose to go the public school route or the private school route. And in doing so, even for the public school route, there are hundreds of options, and you need to pick, I believe it's 12, I think is on the list of schools out of all of that. And so really the idea is not just to pick the school that's closest to your house, but what's both, you know, it's daunting to have to sift through so many high schools, very similar to a college process. But what's also really exciting about the option is that in New York City, especially, you can go ahead and find a high school that specifically meets your particular needs as a student. So it's not just here's a cookie cutter high school and you fit right into that. If you're really interested in the sciences, there are schools that have a really strong science curriculum. If you're interested in American studies, there's for schools that are just focused on American culture and American literature and American history as a focus. If you just want a broad range of options, there's plenty of schools that do that as well. There's schools for writers, schools for artists, and that's a really unique thing that students in this area and also outside of New York City as well have that, but particularly in New York City, this is something that's oftentimes talked about. So I think when working with families, especially who are coming in from the eighth grade into ninth grade and making those decisions, for me, it's very much about what prompted you to pick the schools that you applied to in the first place. And second, what is really, from a value system, what's important to have, so it's not just about here's the right high school to get into the right college, quote unquote, more as here's the right high school because it's going to facilitate a really great 4-year experience between the ages of, you know, 14 and 18 on average. And is it going to be an academically challenging experience, an academically enriching experience? Are you going to feel challenged but also supported? What is needed in the process? What's going to be happening outside of the class? Are there sports activities, theater, clubs and organizations, volunteering? How much does the school support that, or maybe doesn't support it that much, and more is about what you could be doing outside of school unrelated to the school, like as working for a job or dealing with family responsibilities. So really it's important, I think, to learn about schools and break it down based upon value system, location of where you think you might want to be. How far do you want to drive? How far do you want to take public transportation? There's so many different aspects that can go into it. But from a college perspective, it's really a lot about both the academics and also the extracurricular preparation. Those are two parts that for me are the first thing that I come up with, is to say, is it going to fit the right rigor for what it is that your student is at? And is it going to be, you don't want it to be so difficult and so challenging that they don't excel, but there should be some level of rigor that kind of pushes and allows for growth over the next few years in terms of academics, but also extracurricular wise, are there always going to be activities that one can do that can help grow who they are as a person outside of the classroom? So those are the two that are the most important things that I like to focus on when talking to a student.
Love that. I mean, I really always spend time with my students just talking with them about themselves and sort of their experience. One of my favorite things to do is to have an interview where I ask them about each of their subjects, what they like, what they don't like, what they wish for, just to make that really concrete, especially for a rising eighth grader. It can feel a little abstract in terms of saying, well, what, you know, what do you want in a school, right? And so just asking about what their experience is so far, you can usually extract a wish list based on that. And I love what you said about rigor, because I love looking at the course catalogs for different high schools. And you're right, in New York City, we have access to so many different types of high schools. And so you can definitely take a look at the courses and get a sense of how difficult they will get as you grow in the high school. And I always tell students, like, let's try to figure out a school where you can take the top level rigor of that school and do well within. So I'm glad to hear I'm on mark in that advice. And then, you know, but a lot of parents ask questions that have to do with, I guess, things we've heard. So maybe you could kind of demystify some of these urban legends, I guess you could say, right? I mean, so for example, some parents will look at a matriculation list, right? And if they don't see a good number of Ivy League schools or high level schools in terms of competitiveness, if they don't see also maybe a variety of locations of schools, maybe some schools matriculate more to a particular area of the United States versus others. How important is it to look at a matriculation list, and what information can you actually get from it? I imagine each matriculation list has some variability to it, right? Like, for example, you might have 5 kids accepted at one school, but that's not really going to be reflected in the matriculation list that's posted online, right? Or you might not even really know where kids ended up accepting or going to school, really. And so what value does the matriculation list have, and how should you really read it? That's, I guess, what I'm wondering.
So there's two different things. There's a matriculation list, which is simply where a student chooses to go to college upon their completion of high school. And then there's an acceptance list. The acceptance list is something that a lot of schools don't seem to share, which I think is interesting. I think it's actually something that is much more valuable, because the acceptance list is actually going to show you where students have applied and been accepted to. Mm-hmm. So for example, you might have a student who goes ahead over, and usually, just to add, matriculation lists typically can range between 1 and 5 years of that are reported from the high school. So it could be over the course of 5 years, students at a particular school may have made a decision that, and I'm just gonna pick a random college, they could have maybe picked the University of Pennsylvania as a school that's been really popular amongst its student body. But that doesn't necessarily mean that those same students who chose the University of Pennsylvania didn't also get accepted to schools like Columbia and Cornell or Stanford or Michigan or University of Texas or UCLA. It's that they chose to matriculate to the University of Pennsylvania. So I think oftentimes what you might want to be asking family, what families should be asking high schools is, let me see the school profile, which is a document that high schools send to colleges along with your student's transcript upon graduation. It is a document that's not often found, but you can simply ask school counselors for a copy of that particular year's school profile. And school profile puts your student into context of the greater grade that they're in. It changes from year to year in terms of its statistics. But typically the school profile will have a 1 to 5 year matriculation list, but many schools also include an acceptance list with that. So that might be really helpful because for parents who are concerned that a school might not have a huge matriculation list, they could have a list that's maybe 25 or 30 schools on a matriculation list, but its acceptance list is over 100. Because students are applying to 8 or 10 schools, they're getting accepted to those many schools. It's just that they can only choose one. So I think those are different things that the focus tends to be on. Where are they matriculating is different than where are they being applying to and where are they being accepted. So I think as families, to be a little bit more informed consumers, that's a good question to ask coming in is, I'd like to know where your students are choosing to go, but also I'd like to know where they're choosing to apply and be accepted school. And I think for the matriculated list, you have to remember school culture and community culture play a large part into where students choose to go to school for a certain period of time. So you could have really popular schools at a particular juncture of a few years, and that's why you'll have many more students applying to or choosing to attend, because a lot of college decision-making is word of mouth. And so if a student says, oh, I really love the University of Maryland, and it goes through that it's been a great experience for students, more students in the years following will start to apply. And then that might shift after a few years to a small liberal arts college in upstate New York. It could always shift as to what's the popular school. So I think that matriculation list is a valuable resource, but the real thing you want to look at is matriculation plus acceptances. And together, you'll get a much more informed picture.
Oh, that's so helpful. I really didn't realize the difference between the terminology in that level of detail. So that's really very helpful. And what would you say also are other good questions that parents should be asking? Like right now, for example, a lot of parents and students are going to virtual tours of schools. And I imagine that some schools are going to have information about the college process. What kinds of questions should students and their parents be asking the college counselor about, you know, their process beyond the matriculation list and the school profile that you just mentioned?
So two things that come up, hopefully I'll remember both. The two things that come up are a lot of schools will put a limit on the number of AP courses or advanced placement courses or high level rigor courses that a student can take in a given year. Mm-hmm. Some schools don't put a limit, some schools do. There's not a negative or a positive to that. It's just the decision that the school chooses to make. But one of the factors that plays into it is that if a school says, by your junior year, you're only permitted 2 AP courses in 11th grade, but with permission, you can take one more, I think a good question for students to say is, what does that permission mean? What does permission look like? What do you have to have achieved to show the school that you can go beyond the rigor that they deem to be adequate so that a student is pushing themselves, but not too far? But yet if they're giving room for, you know, a little bit more than that, what does that mean? Because I think a lot of times parents come up to it and say, oh, I can take more, but there's very strict criteria to that. And I think knowing early on, where are those limitations or if the school doesn't have any? I think that's a very good question is, are there a limitation on the number of advanced placement or in the case of an IB program, that's a little more structured, so there's not a lot of movement. But in schools that don't have APs, but rather have their advanced seminars or honors classes, is there a limit? And I think that can be really helpful because if a student finds that they really, really want to push themselves, sometimes a school that limits that doesn't allow for that push that they're looking for. I think another good question is, looking at the school day and the timing of the school day, some schools go from, you know, 8 a.m. till 2 o'clock in the afternoon, which allows for a lot of time in the afternoon for extracurricular activities. But there are a lot of schools, particularly private schools, sometimes schools that have dual curriculums where maybe there's a religious component in the education. I know this oftentimes happens in Jewish day schools. Students can be in school from 8 a.m. till 5 o'clock in the afternoon. Every school has a different structure in terms of timing. I think it's important to ask the school, how do I go ahead and do my extracurricular activities? Or how many extracurricular activities does the average student do if they finish school at 2 o'clock versus if they finish school at 5 o'clock? Mm-hmm. And I think that that's an important thing because sometimes, you know, what you do outside of school plays a huge factor in the college admissions process and growing a resume and becoming a leader. But if you're only limited to a couple hours a day versus having 4 or 5 hours a day, sometimes 4 or 5 hours, you can do more with that. Whereas only 2 hours a day, you can only really focus on maybe one or two things in a academic year. So I think if you're the kind of student who really wants to balance what you do outside of school and what you do inside of school, that's a good question to ask as to how does the school support that? Does it provide a lot of, you know, sport activities, musical activities, and how do you want to maybe hear from students, how does that balance work? So I think those are kind of two important questions to ask right off the top of my head. There's many more that you can probably think about, but I think in terms of an academic part is what's the extent of the rigor? And on the other side is how can a student balance in school and out of school, but so that they're making sure they're taking full advantage of both.
Oh, I love that. I love that. I hadn't thought about those questions. So that's really helpful. And I think it's so empowering also when you talk about schedule and sort of what does the schedule allow me to do? It's a really important piece. Similarly, I have some students who are really serious about their extracurricular activity, whether that be a sport or it's drama or art, something of that kind, right? And so as they even look towards college, they sort of already know that they're going to be specializing in something. And I wonder if there are also questions that they should be asking of those programs within the high schools in terms of the college process, and what would those questions be for that particular type of student?
Right. So I think one of the first questions, especially we'll use athletes as an example, and then we can kind of veer off to other, you know, other talents. But if you're an athlete and you're coming into a school, one of the things that's really important is to identify if your particular sport has both school, it has an opportunity in the school where it's a competitive program. And also if you're doing a club sport, which is a sport that you do outside of school, making sure that the school and the club are supportive of each other. Because a lot of times club sport responsibilities are very intense, and there are some club sports that say, we don't want you to participate in a school activity. Mm-hmm. But the school sees you as an excellent athlete and wants you to be a part of their program. You want to try to find schools where there's going to be good communication between coaches to make sure that if you choose to be on a club team and you choose to be on the school team, making sure that it's supportive of both of those opportunities. So that way it doesn't become one's rising to the top, because the person stuck in the middle is the student athlete, and that's a hard, you know, avenue to kind of wander down. But I think it's really helpful that when you're asking the high school, it's more how many students do navigate the world of outside of the school club activities with inside of the school. I think it's important that the school, do they understand the process about athletic recruitment if that is the decision you choose to make? There's the NCAA has very strict requirements in terms of academic preparation for going into college and playing a sport at the highest levels. But there's also just the opportunity of coaches understanding how to help you through the recruitment process. Some schools, just that's not a focus of theirs, and that's okay. But if you want to be in a specific environment where you're going to be supported as an athlete, making sure the coaches understand that process, finding out how many Division I or Division II athletes they have versus Division III or club athletes. Division III and club tend to be, they're both competitive, but on a different level. They don't have the same kind of requirements to be considered. But if you are an athlete who really wants to play at the collegiate level, having a high school coach who really understands that process, and also school counselors who understand that process, because they're going to work together is really, really helpful. And because without that, it becomes a little bit more challenging to navigate. So I think that's the biggest part, is making sure that there's good communication between outside of and inside school, but also does the school have familiarity with the process that you will have to go through in order to be able to be prepared for the college end. In terms of students who are musicians or artists or musical theater, the same thing holds true. Does the school have knowledge about programs on the collegiate level? Do they also have knowledge about how you could go ahead and prepare yourself for, you know, art portfolios? Do they have the ability to help you with making recitals outside of school, or do they have connections to help you do that? Do they have connections from the college end in terms of the audition process? There's little nuances that go on between those programs, and it's really helpful if you have at least one resource within the school system that understands it. So in the art department, does a teacher know how to do a college level art portfolio? In the music department, do they know where there's outside lessons and recital opportunities that could be happening? If it's theater, you know, are there opportunities to how to do a proper, you know, Bachelor of Fine Arts audition for college? So those are things that, when you're looking at a high school, you want to be able to ask the specific departments, how much experience do they have in this process?
That's really helpful. And I think it's so empowering too. I think some of this conversation, I hope that my eighth grade students who are listening, I really want you to take a moment and take some notes here, especially on things Zane is saying around the questions that you can ask. You can ask these questions. It's really about empowering you through the process and finding your own voice in the process as you go along as well. So it's just something I wanted to mention right now as we kind of continue the questions. So a couple of other things just regarding like kind of more nuancey or specific areas of interest that some of my students have. So let's say that you have a student who is going to be in a program for ninth grade. I know some students, for example, go to a K-9 school, and then they're going to be moving to a 10th grade program for a boarding school. Or maybe a student starts off a program and they're not really going to end up staying there for whatever reason, and they're going to move within the high school years to a different school. Can you tell me a little bit about how colleges view that and sort of what do students need to know ahead of time if that's going to be a part of their plan going into high school, or if they could feel a little better about what the strategy might be in that case, what would you say to them?
So the best way to describe it, all across the United States, kids have to move high schools a lot. So it's not this uncommon experience for a student to either be in a program that ends in ninth grade, or that they at some point in their ninth or 10th grade year decide this isn't the right fit for me and I need to make a transition, or family is moving to a completely new area. Colleges are very well aware of that. What ends up happening though is everything you do in high school, no matter what school you're in, matters. So if you're in ninth grade at a K-9 school, and that's the last year, they're going to consider that to be, in most cases, a high school program. So that record of your ninth grade year is going to likely be used by a college admissions office who's going to be evaluating you for ninth, 10th, 11th, and part of 12th grade for college. So it's important to know that wherever you are in school, you have to do your best. There are a lot of conversations about what's the right time to transfer within a high school. You know, there's not a wrong time, but sometimes there's not also a right time. It depends on each individual person. I would oftentimes say that the most of the time I'll find a student will transfer a high school between 10th and 11th grade, there seems to be the easiest of transitions. But from a college point of view, they're fine with that because they're going to look at your 9th and 10th grade record, and then they're going to look through the first full year of what you've performed in your new school. However, if in the transition, because transitioning to a new school is not easy for a lot of students, if during that full year that you're at a new school and you're trying to figure out the curriculum and trying to figure out socially and emotionally and athletically and all these extracurricular things that you do and just figuring out life, if you're not performing at the same level that you're used to, oftentimes college counselors will recommend, and even admissions counselors will recommend, not applying early to college in the fall of your 12th grade year, but to use the fall of your 12th grade year as one extra semester to show your level of performance in high school. Because they recognize there's been a transition, and using that extra semester in your 12th grade now gives it that you're at your new school with 1.5 years worth of information versus 1 year of information. Sometimes that extra semester can give you that momentum of what you had going previously. So there's no negative to the experience. It's more about making sure that you're honest about the experience. You're honest that it's not, for some students, it's not an easy transition, but that colleges are mindful of that. And there are opportunities from a college perspective to explain why it is you made a choice to move, how that choice impacted your academic experience. If there are challenges, there's always room to kind of fix that, especially within the first, few months. But again, they're not going to be comparing the academic experience from one school to the next. They're just going to see how you perform in those two schools to the best of your ability.
Got it. And is the GPA sort of looked at differently when you have two different programs that you're considering? Like you mentioned the school profile earlier.
Yeah.
Does the college get both of the school's profiles, and do they sort of look at the GPA differently given the context of the two different schools, I imagine, but maybe.
So, interestingly, most of the time, if you transfer high schools, you're not sending the school profile for your original high school. You just send the profile for the school that you're going to be graduating from. That's not to say that as a student, you can't reach out to your previous school and ask them for a copy of that, of your graduate, what would have been your graduating year's profile. But many times, as a counselor, I very few times will have sent the previous year's, the previous school's profile.
Got it.
But that's okay. What essentially is happening is that the college is really going to evaluate you, how you're currently performing, to understand where you're currently doing right now, but they're not ignoring the previous year. Like I said, they're looking for trends. They're looking for upward trend in rigor, upward trend in grades, consistency. Those are the things that they're looking for. So they're not as concerned what the school's picture was when you were in 9th or 10th grade, because now you're a year plus older and you're in a new school. What is important, though, is that when you're looking at this context, the colleges for the GPA all do different things. There isn't one cookie cutter way to be able to do a GPA. So sometimes colleges will just take the grade point averages that are given by the high schools. And if it's two high schools, they'll maybe average them together. They'll do whatever. Sometimes they recalculate, meaning they take a whole new picture of your entire transcript and maybe just look at your core subjects of English, math, science, social studies, and foreign language. And that's it. That's all they do. So you could have a GPA that might say a 3.0 at school A, and then at school B, you might have a 3.2, but your core subject matters in both of those schools are pretty high, and you've gotten mostly A's and B's. Your overall GPA by some colleges might actually be a 3.3 or a 3.4, because they're going to recalculate. Every college does it different. When you learn about the colleges, they will clearly tell you how they go about evaluating a GPA. And so it's really more about, there isn't much you can do about it, but everyone's going to look at you differently.
Got it.
In terms of determining the grade point average.
So similarly, a lot of my students, although this happens a little later in the process, as in when they start taking placement tests for 9th grade classes, and maybe even some students are going to be anticipating the start of high school over the summer, and they might do some things to prepare. Like I've had students, for example, preview a course or just make sure that all of their writing skills are up to par, things of that kind, just to make sure their 9th grade years are as strong as possible. But there are still many students that struggle in that 9th grade year. And I guess I wonder if you could speak a little bit to how important it is to have that ninth grade year be strong. What happens if it isn't strong? Is there hope? A lot of students feel a lot of stress over that year because it's a huge transition into perhaps a new school, but also it's the first time everything counts and matters so much. So can you talk a little bit about the ninth grade year and your experiences with students who perhaps need to maybe plan for that? What are some things we can do preemptively to plan for that? And then also, what happens if things don't go well? What information do you have for families just to have in their back pocket for that?
So high school, the best way to describe it is high school is going to give you a little bit more freedom than middle school will have, just like middle school gave you more freedom than elementary school, mm-hmm. kind of a way to look at it. The most important thing to have in terms of preparation, I think, is really having a good sense of organizational skills, time management skills, critical thinking skills, not necessarily related to academics, but how to basically make sure you're understanding how to work with the new social dynamics, especially if you're transitioning to a high school with a new social group, or you have to make a social group, so you have to start thinking about good problem solving and decision making when it comes to meeting new people. I think it's just, these are simple tools that people, adults, have to use to navigate the world. But as going into eighth or ninth grade, I am more focused on not, do you have the right math skills and writing skills? Those are really important. But I do think having strong organizational skills, time management skills, they oftentimes call them executive functioning, which obviously you know. Having those and getting better at that during that transition time is really important, because when you're in high school, it's going to look similar, but you're now going to be having decisions about what happens outside of school. How are you going to balance being an athlete and also be joining a club that's really interesting, mm-hmm. and have 7 classes a day and need to spend time with your friends and your family, knowing how to use an assignment book or a scheduler or, because I still use a book after all these years, or you know, how to use your phone and having a good sense of organization of your time. Understanding how to prioritize is really an important skill, I think, for students, because sometimes if you have a major project coming up, but you have 5 math questions you have to answer, you have to figure out how much time you're going to use for those 5 questions, because you're going to have to spend a couple hours on a project in English. So it's really trying to learn those subtle nuances about how to be stronger in your executive functioning aspect of things is really, I think, paramount to everything. Because if you have a strong sense of how to organize yourself, you're going to be able to manage what's going to start happening in the classes. Doesn't mean you're going to get straight A's, but it's going to mean that you have more control over your time, more control over how to take in the content and know how to organize that in your particular life. And there's some, you know, great resources out there. I know, Mary, that's, you know, a lot of the work that you're able to do with students is to help them navigate that. And I think once you're able to do that, then you can focus on, okay, I've got my life organized. Now I can go ahead and figure out, what help do I need in math? What help do I need in English? How do I process these historical experiences? How do I really write a lab report? All of those things, I think, are going to make it a lot easier to deal with if you have your basic skill sets of how to function in this new world a lot stronger. And so that to me is the biggest focus, is once you have that down, it definitely shows a positive, it has like a trickle down effect that you'll start, your grades will do it. You don't have to have perfect grades in ninth grade, but you do have to show that you're working hard. You do want to get that feedback from teachers that are saying, I see that you're working hard. And in high school, teachers need to see your face after class. If you're struggling, go talk to your teacher. Get to know them. Have a good relationship with them. Meet with them during lunch or study halls if you have to. But you do need to do a little bit more work on your own end to make sure that you understand what it is you need to do to kind of excel in that class at the level that's the right excelling for you.
Right. And do colleges look at the trajectory of your grades over the 4 years if, let's say, your ninth grade year ends up, like, how closely do they look at those grades is my question, in terms of, let's say, ninth grade fall semester, ninth grade spring semester? Is it like that, or is it more cumulative over the entire grade, or both?
It's a little bit of both, but I would say that a college is going to look at things like your grade point average but they love to see an upward trajectory. They really, they don't expect you to be perfect humans. Nobody is. What they do expect, they do want to hear from you and from teachers that you've always tried hard. And so trying hard for one student could be an A+, trying hard for another student could be a B-. And so that's more important, that you're feeling that the grade that is represented on that piece of paper at the end of the day is a representation of the effort you've put in to try to master the information. Mm. We're not going to be perfect at it. Colleges know that. So in high school, if you're starting out with approximately a B average, and you've had A's when you're in middle school, but now you've got a B average in ninth grade because it's taking you time to get used to everything. But now going into 10th grade, you're now having B+ and A-, and those are the things. Colleges love to see that, especially if you can continue along with, you know, B+, A-, maybe a couple of A's going into 11th grade. That kind of trajectory is going to kind of, in some cases, supersede a GPA. So sometimes you'll see a GPA that looks a little lower, and you can attribute that to ninth grade. But then if you take out ninth grade, you've got a much higher grade point average. The colleges may not recalculate just to focus on 10th and 11th, but they're going to see that you've done much better over time. Mm-hmm. And that's what they're looking for. And so, and they'll also take notice of the opposite. If you're doing really well in ninth grade and early 10th grade, and then things start dropping, mm-hmm. and you're going from an A average down to a B or even a high C average, colleges take note of that. So it won't matter that you had done well and had started going down. It's that they're going to take a notice of the drop, and that's going to be a red flag. And they're going to say, what's going on here? They're going to want to know from the counselor, tell us what's happening. You want to be in a position where it's, wow, I'm really impressed that your student has improved versus,
Yes, makes really good sense. I always do tell students that going into high school, even going into eighth grade, I think as you go into this process of looking at high schools, you might really do a dry run in your minds of the high school process. And if you start to see your grades in eighth grade going down, you might start to take action sooner than you think you should to speak with your teachers and get support and really follow feedback. Sometimes some students will gloss over feedback, or they won't fully understand feedback. And I always tell students, it's really your right as a student to be understanding why you got the grade that you got and how you can move forward differently to increase your grade. And that is usually formed with a strong partnership between yourself and the teacher of the course. And that is built up over time when you are struggling, but also maybe when you're not necessarily struggling. It's always okay to go to a teacher and say, I just want to make sure I have this down. Could I just process this with you? Or could I just have a few more practice problems just to make sure I really know this material? These are really helpful habits to have in place anyway. And then if you do it in eighth grade, it becomes part of what you do in high school when the stakes are just higher and you have enough new things to be thinking about. So hopefully this won't be another new thing to think about. Yeah. So I love empowering students to do those kinds of things. I often find the students that really are struggling at the end of ninth grade have spent a lot of time in their ninth grade year not addressing issues of confusion as they actually come up. And it really does become a snowball effect, right? So it's just, these are just good habits in general, you know, being a student, but I think it's particularly important as students like the college process and everything like that. So I also want to ask you just a little bit about testing. And I know many students are taking the test for getting into high school. So they're going to be taking, you know, an SSAT or an ISEE. And then as soon as they begin high school, sometimes parents say, when are we supposed to start studying for the SAT? When are we supposed to be doing the SAT subject tests? Just give me sort of some flavor as to the timelines that you generally ask families to follow so that these families who are watching now, who are a little bit early in the game, kind of have that in mind as they go forward.
Yeah. I take the mindset that it's never too early to start, but it's always too early to start. And the reason I say that is I am a college counselor. I am not a fan of standardized testing. I understand that it is why it has been around for generations. I studied it in school. But I am now seeing that it is, to me, not a very strong representation of a student's ability to succeed, and also just doesn't play a factor in a lot of college admissions decisions that are going on right now. But that doesn't mean it's been wiped, the slate is clean, and we don't have to worry about this. And so I think from the perspective of how to start preparing, I think the number one thing that families need to start doing is creating a reading culture in their own home. So a lot of students, because of our phones, because of social media, and just because of the way that we access the world now, reading and reading for pleasure is not something that is oftentimes done. And a lot of students used to read for pleasure as kids, like younger kids. That was normal. Schools required students to read a book. As you get older, schools will require a book reading, but when it's very academic in nature, it's not the same experience. What I tell students and families is, as early as middle school, is please read for pleasure. If you have the type of student who is not going to sit down and read a book, find a periodical like the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, Economist Magazine, periodicals that have a high level of writing in terms of their standard of writing is a bit higher than some other periodicals. Have your student begin by doing the simple activity of purchasing the Sunday New York Times, the physical paper, preferably. Purchase the physical paper and have your student pick one section of that paper. And every day have them read one article. And in that article for that day, have them circle the words they do not know and put them into like a list on their phone and have them find out what the definition of that word is. And that's a simple activity that any student can do, and parents can do it as well. It's a great conversation starter. The reason you want to do that is reading is a fundamentally important part of the process to do standardized testing. There are long reading passages. The more you read, typically the faster you're able to get through. So that helps with kind of speed processing. The second part is getting a greater vocabulary and exposure to vocabulary that you're not accustomed to using in your everyday language, but are going to be seen in passages that are on these standardized tests. Third, understanding not just seeing them in context, but really understanding definitions or multiple definitions is going to be helpful in the language sections of a lot of these tests. And fourth, I think it just gives you an understanding of popular culture. So a lot of standardized testing used to have essay writing parts. They don't have, a lot of them don't have them anymore, but they're still there that you can take advantage of. But a lot of the different sections, whether it's a math section, a science section, a reading, anything like that, sometimes is related to popular culture themes. And to have an understanding of that because you're reading periodicals, for example, or books, is going to really help you when you go ahead, and it's going to ask you what your opinion is, but you have to support your opinion with factual information, which oftentimes can be found in well-written, you know, pieces of journalism. So that to me is something that students can start as early as elementary school, but definitely in middle school. I think that practice needs to take place throughout the duration of high school. It's kind of just a habit. I think in terms of preparation, once your student has figured out how to adjust to high school, don't start the testing process until that happens. For some students, that's 10th, 11th grade, but usually I don't recommend that there's a lot of test prep in earnest in 9th grade. I think it's more about the transition to high school. Coming into 10th grade, oftentimes for families, is the first exposure to PSATs. Have your student go into them dry so that they just see what it's like, see that's as the baseline. But really it's working with making sure that they're at the level of math that they can understand what's gonna be on the test. The SAT and the ACT will test you on algebra 2 through a little bit of trigonometry / pre-calculus. So that's not something you have to worry about until 11th grade. If you are an advanced math student and you choose to take the test earlier, you should generally be okay. But I think more or less, it's just becoming familiar with the test. As it gets closer, it should be something like training for a marathon. You start a few months before the actual test, and your student should be practicing 4 or 5 times a week at a small amount of time each to see that they have a general understanding of what the test looks like and how to manage it. But traditionally from middle school to high school, I tell students focus on getting into 9th grade and transition, but constantly keep reading. You're not really going to start the testing process until 10th, and definitely not for the ACT and SAT until 11th.
Okay. Yeah, I totally make sense. I love that exercise that you just suggested. I'm going to get that going in my house. I was thinking about how to use the summertime, and you've just given me a good idea.
it's also good because it's good conversation at the dinner table.
It's also just good general fund of knowledge, and it's really great to empower students to be thinking about the world in general and what they can do to improve it. It's definitely something that will also support their college process to be engaged in that kind of thinking. And I love a student who has ideas and who is really excited about acting on them. So that's really very exciting. So anything else you want to share with us during this conversation? Anything else that you think a student, so we're just, you know, we're really gearing this towards students who are in the high school process this fall of 2020, and sort of what should they be thinking about? Maybe something more exclusive to this time period. And is there anything that you feel you want to make sure you deliver to everyone watching as a closing piece?
I think the most important thing is to remember that high school is not it doesn't have to be a means to an end. It doesn't have to be you're in high school so you can go to college. Let high school be your experience. Let high school be what it is. It can be challenging. It can be fun. It can be very different. It's a chance for exploration as to who you are as a person, what you think you might be interested in studying, just for your own intellectual interests. But I think really focus on it simply for what it is, which is an important part of the growing process, and focus on that, especially from 8th to 9th grade. And I think also in this particular time, I think it's really important for families to know what's going on currently in the college admissions process will not be the same at the time that your student applies to college. This situation, we oftentimes tell parents who have two students who are only a few years apart, they'll oftentimes go, "This looks nothing like my first child. This process looked nothing like it." It's because it's constantly evolving. So as an 8th grade to 9th grade parent, there are certain things that will be similar, but it's all going to be very different. So you can't necessarily plan down to, you know, dot every I and cross every T. You can't, you can't do that exactly as you would like, because we don't know exactly what the outcome is going to look like. So I think that really encourages people to focus on making sure your student is going to be ready to be in a situation where they're academically interested, they're engaged in the community they're choosing to be a part of or zoned to be a part of, that they take advantage of the opportunities in class and out of class, that they meet, that they have a good social network. Social circle doesn't have to be huge, but even just a couple of really strong friendships that student can make a world of difference. And just feeling that there are other adults in your student's life that they can go to during what can be a challenging time in life, and being in a community of people where teachers and counselors and administrators are going to be there to support your kid when in those moments where your student might not want to come to you as a parent, which is a normal teenage thing, that they have other resources to go to. So I think that is the primary focus that I would really encourage families to do, is to just appreciate this time, appreciate the excitements, appreciate the challenges, and just know that everything is always going to be okay.
Yes, absolutely. Well, I think it will, as long as, again, we're so privileged to have your expertise and just to be able to be informed with all of those college questions that are going to come up in the high school process. So how can families find you if they want to talk further?
So the best way to reach out to me, I'm Dana Ponsky. The best way to reach out is consultwithdana.com is my website. I do have a Facebook page with the same name. I have an Instagram page with the same name. Basically, go onto my website. I do consultations by phone, Skype, Zoom, WhatsApp. I've got students from around the world, and WhatsApp is the way that we have to do it. So, and there's also a contact form that's available online, but feel free to reach out to me in any of the ways that I have available on my website. And I'm happy to help with any part of the process. I try to make this, what can be stressful, very stressless. So it's really more just figuring out a best way to make everyone be the best versions of themselves. And when you do that, you'll oftentimes find the right outcome will find its way to you because of that. And that's really important for me.
That's wonderful. Yes. And I've loved learning with you. I feel as though because my expertise really does end in high school, it's always really important for me to learn from someone who has your experience, because I do find that some of my families do really want to know all of the ins and outs of the schools that they're looking at and what the college process is going to look like. So I also want to urge anyone watching, if they're interested in just having that conversation with the expert, that's why we're talking to Dana to get that information.
I'm here.
The wheelhouse sort of stops at high school for me. So I always have to say, even though that's the case, I definitely want to bridge the conversation to the next step, because it's always about just planning and making sure that you don't make a decision that you will ultimately regret because you didn't have the questions at the start of it to ask, right? And to get the information. So I really appreciate this. It's so fun to be able to call Dana at any time and be like, wait, what do we do with this? What do we do with that? So I'm going to sign off for now, but we're going to put this, obviously it's on our YouTube channel, and in the notes below, we have Dana's bio and contact information, as well as other pieces that we'll be doing together in terms of support for our kids. So I'm going to stop there, and thanks so much, Dana, for joining us.
Thank you so much for everything.
Yeah.